Now, here in Tyneswell, they're trying to build a reputation as a haven for food lovers. But the town of Pontefract has been renowned amongst people with a sweet tooth since the Middle Ages. That is, as long as you like licorice. Keely Donovan takes a look at the town that's a big name in the world of sweets.
I'm in Pontefract, one of the oldest market towns in Yorkshire. It's also the licorice capital of Britain. 100 years ago, there were 16 licorice factories in the town. Now, there are just two, but it's an industry that still survives today. And this is what it's all about, the Pontefract cake. It's a mix of treacle, sugar and licorice. But how do you make it? Let's find out. I'm meeting a man whose family worked in the licorice industry for more than a century. Hello, Tom. Oh, nice to see you.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, let's go and see these plants
then. Come on then, let's show you them.
So, Tom, these are some of the last licorice plants in Pontefract, is that right?
That's right. These have been in approximately 15 years.
Wow. And they're much taller than I thought they were going to be. I thought they were going to be like little shrubs on the ground.
No. When they die back in the winter now, they'll go down to nothing. Then, come April, May, they start to grow, and they're just at their prime now.
And which part of the plant is actually the licorice? I can't tell which part it'd be.
Those roots grow as thick as my leg. And when you dig them up, they're absolutely oozing out with black juice. And it's that black juice that goes solid, just like a block of coal. And it's that's the pure licorice.
When medieval monks tried to grow the Mediterranean licorice plant in England, one of the very few places where soil conditions were right was Pontefract.
In Pontefract, growing licorice was big business, but the last commercial crop was harvested in 1966. Now it's imported from the Middle East. So, Tom, once upon a time, all of these fields were licorice, is that right?
Oh, yeah, when I was a kid of 5 years old, you came down here and you looked all over here and you saw nothing but licorice plants.
Because it really was the business in Pontefract, wasn't it?
Well, it was, yes, up to the 1970s.
The licorice fields of Pontefract were a local landmark. You must have some great memories of these fields.
Oh,
then.
Wonderful memories. I mean, we used to play all the time. We used to play hide and seek, and my mother could never find me. I can see my mother now and my auntie shouting, "Where the hell are you?" And I'd be in the middle of fields somewhere with all my mates playing Indians and Cowboys.
It was an era when men went down the pit and women worked in the licorice factories.
If you worked at licorice works, you were automatically called a pumper, the Spanish pumper. It's in that game. And I weren't a thumper.
They did licorice all sorts in big sheets and they went onto boards to set, and we used to have to strip this sheet off and take them into the cutting rooms.
One of the factory girls had moved from Germany to post-war Pontefract. Eventually she settled in, but it took time.
I was never quite accepted. For one, I was German, and for the other, my husband was not a miner.
The one thing I did really like was the coconut mushrooms. It was to sneak up to the room where they were made and sneak a few.
My sisters used to come every Tuesday with their two boys, so I used to put my slats on every Tuesday because I could just get half a dozen in my pocket. I'd never got caught.
Now chocolate dominates the sweet market, but licorice gave jobs to hundreds of local women, mass-producing a recipe with origins in the Middle Ages. I'm going to a cookery demonstration, and I've got a confession to make. Now, Tom, I'm going to let you into a little secret.
Go on, then.
I'm not that keen on licorice, so you're going to have to convince me.
By the time I finish with you today, you will love the stuff.
OK.
We go in the fields and we dig this up, the roots.
OK.
We compress the roots and press all the juice out, and it comes out like that. And that's a block of pure licorice.
So purely squeezing and compressing
that's
that...
Squeezed, and that's
squeezed... made that?
It goes solid and it comes out like a block of coal. 50 times sweeter than sugar, the sweetest thing on God's earth.
Why can't you just eat that? Why is that not...
Because it's too strong.
OK.
Far too strong. So what we did at the licorice factories, you put flour into the pans, started stirring them, then you added demerara sugar, kept the big stirring pans going round and round. This was getting thicker and thicker and thicker. And then you had a black treacle. So now we had a big sticky mess going round. And then, to give it the flavour, you used to add a little bit of licorice. We put that in, mixed it all up. We added some of this.
Okay, what's this?
That is ragus. What does ragus spell backwards? Sugar. It stops the sweets going back to sugar.
Okay.
And then the final shot was a little drop of aniseed, and you could smell it all over the town. The aroma was wonderful. We kept it stirring for about 3.5 hours. Mm. We emptied it into big pans for it to be cooled overnight. Then it came out like that, just like your mother used to bake bread. The girls would roll it out like that. They would nip it onto trays, hit it with a stamp, and they made the Pontefract cake.
And that's how you get a Pontefract cake.
That's the finished product.
It's a classic scene in silent cinema. Charlie Chaplin is so hungry, he eats an old boot. But it wasn't leather, it was licorice. And apparently, the boot was from Pontefract. Or at least that's what Tom says.
I got a phone call from a gentleman, and he said, my grandfather got a phone call from Hollywood. They asked him if he could make a boot out of licorice.
Tom's got a replica of Charlie's boot, but unfortunately, licorice doesn't last forever.
You've not been tempted to have a nibble of it yourself, then?
Smell it, would you?
It smells like old boots.
Correct, smells like old boots.
Pontefract's got a proud history of licorice going back 500 years, and some campaigners want to make sure it isn't forgotten.
No other town has the history of licorice like Pontefract, but we've no record of the history and the culture of licorice in Pontefract, and so we're wanting to create a licorice museum to explain and educate.
It has to be the biggest day of the year for Yorkshire's licorice lovers. It's the annual Licorice Festival in Pontefract. There's no museum yet, but this is the one day a year when Pontefract really celebrates its heritage. So how important is the festival for Pontefract?
Oh, I would say, Keely, it's very, very important. As you'll see today, it's attracted thousands and thousands of people from all over the country.
Pontefract's fields of licorice have gone, but it's still the hometown of an industry that's become a worldwide business.
This, in all honesty, this isn't Pontefract licorice. I think this is Scandinavian.
Yeah, some of it's Scandinavian.
Most of
yeah.
It's Scandinavian, is this. And these, are what they've got a big order in Japan and China, and they've got over £1 million worth. And if we put them together, they stretch from here to China, along the sea, they've sold that many.
Forget about chocolate. For some sweet lovers, licorice is still best. And I think I'm getting a taste for it.
Kids absolutely love this. You cannot but get enough of it. Soft licorice.
It's a bit Moorish as well, isn't it?
Very Moorish.
So I've seen lots of strange licorice-flavoured foods here. Licorice ice cream, licorice beer. But this has got to be the strangest. A licorice burrito.
Good, actually.
Licorice will always be at the heart of Pontefract. For Tom, it's a love that'll never go away.
When I die, they're going to put a bag of Pontefract cakes in my coffin, and I don't want a wreath, I want a bunch of licorice on my coffin.